We're live.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Let's go ahead and pray before the worship and invite the Lord's presence even more. Heavenly Father, we say thank you that we can come this morning into your presence because you have freely given us yourself.
Thank you, Lord.
We love you, Jesus. We want more of you today. Hungry and thirsty.
Yes, Jesus.
Come, Holy Spirit, today. Fill us to overflowing.
Hallelujah.
There's no place I'd rather be.
There's no place I'd rather be.
There's no place I'd rather be. Here in your love, here in your love.
No place I'd rather be.
There's no place I'd rather be.
No place I'd rather be.
Here in your love, it's here in your love. So set a fire down in my soul. I can't contain, I can't control.
No place I'd rather be.
Here in your love, here in your love.
No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be. No place I'd rather be.
Here in your heart, here in your love.
Fire down in my soul. Can't control.
I want more of you, God.
More of you, God.
Set a
fire down in my soul
that I can't contain
and I can't control. More of you,
God.
Amen.
More of you, God.
Praise you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. I am
here in your presence, God. I just want to wait on you. Cause I know you love me for who I am. I just want to rest right now. I just want to lay.
I just want to rest in love. I just want to.
whom you set free, I shall be free indeed. Let it all go. Let it all go. I just want to see you for the Lord. I let it all go. Let it all go. Let it all go.
Yeah.
Yes, I lift you up higher. glorify you, King of Kings.
Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise you.
We declare out loud our hunger for you, Jesus.
Rising
up. Rising up. I'm going deeper now. And you, my King. I just want. Praise you, Lord Jesus. He's just saying these words. He's saying there's no more imitation. I'm the true source of life.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
There's no more striving.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's no more pride.
No more pride. Amen. No more pride. Oh, my gosh. Lord. Thank you, see you preparing the soil. Praise you, Lord Jesus.
Digging it up all the night.
Thank you, Jesus.
You're releasing your good seed until we receive our prayer. We just want to seek you all our hearts. We just want to seek you for all that you are.
Thank you, Jesus, for my friend. Thank you, Jesus, for Zachary. Thank you, Jesus.
More living water be poured out on us. Refresh us, Lord. Refresh us. Refresh us. Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Give them strong words this morning, this afternoon, and tomorrow.
Praise you, Lord Jesus.
They will transform, shift the atmosphere, not only in this room, but over the airways, but even this region, the county, Seattle, the whole region out here. Just take a deep breath with me right now. There's just like a purified, holy air.
Jesus.
This is being released in this room. You see, worship is a weapon of our warfare that disarms the spirits that live in this region, even the principalities. That God can break through in many ways. Some of you know I took Nelson out of my boat Thursday, and I didn't realize what a teenager he really is.
Amen.
And we had a lot of fun as we as we cruised around the San Juan Islands and enjoyed God's creation. One of my sons went with us, and we just really had fun.
Yes, we did.
You know, last night we had three or four people that were really touched by the Lord, and one of them was a guy that works for me. He had been in prison for 28 years, and his shoulders had been just bound up for, I don't know, I think 3 months, where he could only raise them like this, you know, not even above his shoulder right here. And he literally, I saw him this morning in a warehouse where he's working right now. He's like, I'm still healed, and he's waving like this. He goes, that's so awesome.
You know? Wow.
And so,
so
I
cool.
Really believe that God's going to continue to heal people over the next four sessions, including today.
Amen.
No matter what it is, God knows who's in the room. I think there's still people on their way that are coming in, and especially some of you online as well that are watching Nelson's feed and my feed. And so we're looking forward to seeing what God has in store. And I'm just going to turn it over to you and look forward to seeing what God's going to do today.
Amen.
Let's welcome Nelson.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's see. So who was not here? You guys were not here. You guys were not here last night. And the rest of you were here. So, all right, great. Last night was building. And every time we do one of these sessions, more and more of us building. For those of you that weren't here last night, you know, some of you, I think, watched online. So it's been amazing. In fact, it was amazing to learn last night that there was a lady that came from Washington, D.C., that flew in for this conference specifically. So it's amazing how far that people will go for freedom. I mean, my gosh, I know personally going through a whole bunch of horribleness with relationships, and I would do anything to find a source that would help get free freedom, because it's no fun having no peace And that's essentially what I deal with, you know, people that struggle. When I was the spirits of Jezebel, spirits of Wythron, no peace, no peace. There's never any peace, never peace in their minds, never any peace with those who have relationships with them as well. Because that's what the demonic spirit's goal is to cause division, cause confusion, cause selfishness and control, manipulation, and pride. And I was asking the Lord this morning, I'm like, what do you want me to speak about this morning? Because I always let the Holy Spirit guide and direct whatever I speak. I don't have any plans. Same thing with my Facebook lives I do every day with teaching. And I'm like, what am I going to talk about today? I don't even have a clue. And oftentimes I'll give you a title of it, and then I don't know what the details are going to be, which I love that. So today, we went for a walk, and it was so beautiful, so warm outside. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm like, we should do this outside on a boat at the San Juan Islands and take a ride. Oh my gosh, it was so beautiful. I was like in a different world. I'm like, oh my gosh, where am I at? It's like, they should make the movies here. Because it's like you're in a different area. We were like, he got the engine right in front of where the Olympia mountains were, like to the left, and then Canada was straight on, and then there's an island over here to the right. I'm like, oh my gosh, I want to stay here forever. So I took a video of it that actually I watched this morning. And the Lord has taken me literally around the country now about 4 or 5 times since 2017. I've been in full-time ministry. I used to sell software at banks. I used to manage relationships for the largest banking core processors in the United States. And I work for the largest internet banking software company in the United States. So it's funny how I used to manage relationships corporately. Now I'm helping relationships personally because I went through stuff myself that was not fun to go through. And because of that, out of that comes an anointing. You know, if I did not know, didn't go through what I went through, I couldn't speak on this because I would have no experience. And experience is the best teacher. The Lord takes us through oftentimes some unpleasant things that are hell in order to come out of that so you can bring heaven to earth. And you know, Paul says count it all joy when we go through various trials and tribulations. But sometimes I'm like, okay, I'm not really in much joy right now. Like, I want this season to be over. Sometimes it takes years before that season gets over. So anyway, this morning I said, Lord, what am I going to be talking about today? I have no clue. And he's like, why don't you talk about pride? And that's what Mike mentioned there at the end, was pride. And I'm like, huh. I'm like, yeah. I go, that's a subject that is, it's an area in our lives we all have to look at, no matter where we're at, no matter what age we're at, no matter what position we're at, no matter where we're at, say we're in ministry. There's so many that I have run now around the country several times in Canada and have run into people where I can sense there's pride. It's not, you know, I always say pride stinks to high heaven, and it does. You know, it got a certain person kicked out of heaven named Lucifer because of his pride. And so many of us, when we get hurt when we're growing up, and we've been hurt by a father, by a mother, by a stepfather, stepmother, through sexual violations, through satanic ritual abuse, I mean, when we get hurt in deep, deep ways, what happens is the Leviathan spirit, which is in Job 41, says in verse 34, it's king over all the children of pride. In fact, what it says to read that. Okay, I haven't read that for a while. I'm going to read the entire Job 41. I haven't done this for a long time. And because oftentimes, well, all the time, you don't hear it preached on in church. You just don't. And so I'm like, this is so important to read because why don't the pastors read about this? Well, oftentimes they don't understand it. And they're not taught this in Bible school and seminary. You know, and I didn't even know it existed. In fact, when the Lord told me about this in 2015, I was like, what is Leviathan? I've never even heard of that. And how does it work? Well, I know how it works now. So I'm going to read about this, and then I'm going to dive down into this. So Job 41 says, can you draw out Leviathan with a hook, or snare his tongue with a line which you lower? Can you put a reed through his nose, or pierce his jaw with a hook? Will he make many supplications to you? Will he speak softly to you? Will he make a covenant with you? Will you take him as a serpent forever? Will you play with him as with a bird? Or will you leash him for your maidens? Will your companions make a banquet of him? Will they apportion him among the merchants? Can you fill his skin with harpoons, or his head with fishing spears? lay your hand on him, remember the battle, never do it again. Indeed, any hope of overcoming him is false. Shall one not be overwhelmed at the sight of him? No one is so fierce that he would dare stir him up. Who then is able to stand against me, which is God? Who has preceded me that I should pay him? Everything under heaven is mine. Not conceal his limbs, his mighty power, or his graceful proportions. Who can remove his outer coat? Who can approach him with a double bridle? Who can open the doors of his face with his terrible teeth all around? His rows of scales are his pride. Shut up tightly as with a seal. One is so near another that no air can come between them. They are joined one to another. They stick together and cannot be parted. His sneezings flash forth light, and his eyes are like the eyelids of the morning. Out of his mouth go burning lights. Sparks of fire shoot out. Smoke goes out of his nostrils, as from a boiling pot and burning rushes. His breath kindles coals, and a flame goes out of his mouth. Strength dwells in his neck, and sorrow dances before him. The folds of his flesh are joined together. They are firm on him and cannot be moved. His heart is as hard as stone, even as hard as the lower millstone. When he raises himself up, the mighty are afraid. Because of his crashings, they are beside themselves. For the sword reaches him, it cannot avail, nor does spear, dart, or javelin. He regards iron as straw, and bronze as rotten wood. The arrow cannot make him flee. Sling stones become like stubble to him. Darts are regarded as straw. He laughs at the threat of javelins. His undersides are like sharp potsherds, which are like broken pots, pottery, sharp. He spreads pointed marks in the mire. He makes the deep boil like a pot. He makes the sea like a pot of ointment. He leaves a shining wake behind him. One would think the deep had white hair. On earth, there is nothing like him, which is made without fear. He beholds every high thing, which is every prideful thing. He is king over all the children of pride. So what happens when we get hurt when we're growing up is we start to hear the voice of the enemy. And a part of that is the Leviathan spirit. Leviathan spirit is pride. What that tells us, when we get hurt, we basically start to have thoughts from the enemy coming in telling us that we can't trust whoever it was that hurt us. Oftentimes it's our father or mother. Sometimes it can be those who have touched us sexually or have exposed us to pornography or things that are sexual. And so when that all happens, it causes us to hear the thoughts from the enemy, and really this little Leviathan spirit, telling us that we cannot trust anyone, especially if it's your father or your mother or stepfather, stepmother, or parental figure who hurts us. Because it tells us, okay, we can't trust them, so then we surely can't trust God. And we need to listen to the inner voice in our head, and that will give us the best decisions and the best outcome. So what happens is when we get into relationships later, the enemy will tell us that every decision that we make is the right one, and whoever else comes against us is doing wrong. And so if we're hearing the voice of a demonic spirit making the decisions to tell us what to do, we're going to make bad decisions. We're going to ruin our own relationships. We're going to hurt our own offspring. We're going to infect our own children. We're going to blame them and say that they are the ones that are the screw-ups when, unfortunately, we have been messed up. We have been hurt. We've not gotten free delivered yet. And we take out all of that pain on our own children. And that infects them. And so we have pride. And when we have pride, we basically cannot see ourselves as doing anything wrong or anything bad. We can't. We just can't. We can't admit it. So therefore, we blame everybody else, and then we end up hurting our relationships, breaking our relationships, going from one relationship to another, blaming everyone else. And as a part of that, oftentimes we will have sickness, we will have pain, we will have disease that will come upon us. And I'm going to read here, and it says, Proverbs 6, 16 through 19. These six things the Lord hates. Yes, seven are an abomination to him. A proud look. So he does not like a proud look. In fact, he hates that. He hates pride. It got Satan kicked out of heaven because of pride. It goes on and says, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil, a false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord among brethren. All of those are describing people that struggle with the spirits of Jezebel and Leviathan, which is a lot of people. Those are the people that have been hurt the deepest, hurt the worst. So there's an example in the Bible. Again, Jezebel's in 1 Kings and 2 Kings, also in Revelations 2, 18 and 23. She was married to King Ahab, and she basically took control over King Ahab of the kingdom, and she told other people what to do, and she killed the prophets of the Lord. And that people that struggle today with the spirits of Jezebel and Leviathan will try to shut down the true Holy Spirit from operating in the churches and come against those who are already hurting, looking to be helped, and try to inflict more pain upon them. So pride can literally cause us to have a lot of sickness and pains and disease in our bodies if we don't deal with it. So here's an example. This is in 2 Kings 5, 8 through 16. It says, so it was, when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, why have you torn your clothes? Please let him come to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel. Then Naaman went with his horses and chariots, and he stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored to you, and you shall be clean. For you see, what happened to Naaman was that he wanted to be cleansed because he had a disease. He had leprosy. And that was like a death sentence. And so, when he was told to go wash in the Jordan 7 times and his flesh would be restored to him, Naaman became furious. He went away and said, indeed, I said to myself, he will surely come out to me and stand and call the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and heal the leprosy. Are not the Abana and the Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. How many that are in the church walk in pride and do not want to humble themselves? And you can imagine when it comes to healing, the Lord wants to heal all of us, absolutely positively. But if you have a lot of pride, that's going to get in the way, and now you don't have the pain to try to get your attention to say, maybe I need to look inside, maybe I need to forgive some people, maybe I need to address the pride in my own life. And if you get healed, you just have more pride, and now you don't have the pain to deal with it. So in a lot of cases, it's like the Lord is waiting on us to humble ourselves and say, okay, I'm going to repent for this pride. I want to be healed. But there's things in my life that I need to deal with. So he went away in a rage, you know, in pride, and his servants came near and spoke to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says to you, wash and be clean? So he went down and dipped 7 times in the Jordan. Anyone here ever been to the Jordan River? I've been there once. Was baptized there, and it is dirty. They have rats there and stuff. So he went down and did 7 times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Oftentimes when we go through deliverance, the Lord shows me, we become childlike. We have fun. We don't throw pity parties. We don't have selfishness. We're like a little child, and we want to go and go on adventures and say, oh my gosh, what's around the corner? What's going to happen if we go on the boat today? Where are we going to go? It's like, oh my gosh, every day for me, it's like, I'm excited. I have fun. I have joy every single day. I can't wait to wake up. I can't wait to go to sleep so I can have dreams. I can't wait to wake up and then be surprised what God's going to do. So many people have gotten delivered saying, my gosh, I've got childlike innocence now. I've been restored of what was stolen from my childhood by the enemy and by the demons and those people who have hurt me. So his flesh was restored like a little child, and it was clean. And he returned to the man of God, he and all his clothes, and came and stood before him. And he said, indeed, now I know that there is no Allah in all the earth except in Israel. Now therefore, please take a gift from your servant. But he said, as the Lord lives, before whom I stand, I will receive nothing. And he urged him to take it, but he refused. So, it's amazing. So, so amazing when we realize that, okay, maybe I'm dealing with some pride issues. And it's really hard to see it because the enemy and the Leviathan spirit blinds us so that we don't ever see ourselves. I used to struggle with a lot of pride, and I didn't want to admit that. I would never admit that. I didn't see it. It's like, oh no, I have no pride. I'm the humblest man on earth, you know? And just look back, I'm like, oh my gosh, I was really prideful. I was really prideful. And what happens oftentimes is when you, say, make a lot of money, that's why they say it's so hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, because they don't really have to trust the Lord for a lot of things. They have their money. And it's sad because oftentimes they're not going to heaven. May end up dying. Not saying that every rich person like that, but a lot are, because they can trust themselves for the money. So the Bible, when we read some more scriptures here, says James 4:6 says, but he gives more grace. Therefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. James 4:10, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. And I'm seeing that a lot too, where there's a lot going on right now in the church, where there's a lot of leaders in the leadership positions that operate in the spirit of Leviathan and Jezebel, and they're very prideful. The Lord is humbling a lot, and he's given them time to repent, and they won't. And so what he's doing is taking those who have already been humbled, whose hearts are like Christ, and he's promoting them now all over the world. In small churches and bigger churches, when we truly have the heart's Father and the Father's heart, then there's nothing that he won't do for us. But there's a lot of people out there that are operating in a lot of deep, dark sin, and the Lord is waiting for them to humble themselves. And if they won't do it, he will do it for them. He will do it in a way that will humble them completely, and it's for their own good, so that they can actually get truly saved. And then actually make it to heaven versus walking in the spirits of Jezebel, Leviathan, and hurting God's people and walking in the flesh. So Proverbs 29:23 says, a man's pride will bring him low, but the humble in spirit will retain honor. Proverbs 19:9, a false witness will not go unpunished, and he who speaks lies shall perish. So what are some of the signs of pride? I've got, I think, I don't know, 20 some here listed. I'm going to read these and just listen. Let the Holy Spirit show you. Because what we want to do is we want to repent for the pride. We want to kick out the spirit of Leviathan. The only way we can do that is if we humble ourselves and we admit it, we've got some of this in us. If we don't want it, then it'll have to go. If we say, oh, forget this, this isn't me, nope, don't have any of that, then it gets to stay. It can torment us and ruin our lives. So, okay, the first one is assuming you already know something when someone is trying to teach you something. When you immediately tune someone out who starts teaching you something that you may be somewhat familiar with, that is an example of pride. It is the assumption that you know everything about the subject that's being communicated, and that this person who you see as inferior in knowledge to you cannot teach you something new. Next one. Seeing yourself as too good to perform certain tasks. When someone asks you to do something and your immediate thought is, I, out of all people, should not have to do that, that task is for someone else. That is a sign of pride that we should consider dealing with. Next time this thought arises, ask yourself, if Jesus was willing to leave heaven and come to earth for me, then who am I to say I am too good to do what someone else asked me to do? Number three, being too proud to ask for help. Remember before we had GPS, and me being a guy, used to drive, and I remember, like, my wife, if I got lost, she'd be like, hey, we should pull over and ask somebody. I'm like, oh no, I can figure this out. And then it'd be like a half an hour later, and I'm like, finally, I figured this out. I'm like, Well, that was pride. I should have pulled over and asked somebody. So how many times has that ever happened to us? There's something to be said for independence. However, there are times in life when we must all admit that something's beyond our capacity and that we need help. The unwillingness to recognize our own shortcomings and need for help is a sign of pride. Number four, you feel a need to consistently teach people things. Have you ever been in a group where someone feels the need to dominate the conversation and seemingly spill everything they know without giving other people the opportunity to share? Sometimes this can be a sign of pride because when a person knows something that they know most other people don't know much about, it creates a sense of pride within them. Five, talking about yourself a lot. You ever know people that are like that? And maybe it's ourselves. When you talk a lot about your accomplishments, your education, your title, your position, your financial status, that's a sign of pride. The Bible says, be quick to listen and slow to speak, James 1:19. When we talk about ourselves a lot, it reveals that we have not yet learned how to come up out of ourselves and focus on the interests of others. Number six, thinking you are better than others who are different or less fortunate. This one is subtle because a person can appear to be humble and caring on the outside. However, in their minds, they secretly think they are better than other people who may have different backgrounds, cultures, or experiences than they do. Number seven, when you disregard the advice of others, this has its root in thinking that you have all the answers in life, and that you somehow don't need or see the value in other people's perspectives. It carries the idea that you believe you can be successful and accomplish your goals without the counsel of others. Number eight, and I see this all the time with people that struggle, having their soul been sold yet. Number eight, when you are consistently critical. Anyone know people that are critical? And they criticize and judge all the time? This is when we tend to put others down often because there is a deep-seated need for us to feel better about ourselves. People who are critical are that way because they secretly see themselves as exempt from the very same things that they criticize others for. This is pride. Number nine, consistent need for attention and affirmation. When someone constantly needs to be the center of attention in public, or secretly craves consistent affirmation for their accomplishments, looks, personality, serving, intelligence, or physique, this is a sign of pride. And that's a lot of people. Again, when you know who you are in Christ, you don't really need to be the center of attention anymore. Christ is the center of attention. You want to help other people. You're not going to make it all about you. So, number 10. Unable to receive constructive criticism. When a person struggles to allow other people to speak into their lives and provide helpful feedback, it's a sign of pride, because they are too blinded by their own pride to see the value of what someone else is sharing with them, how it might be able to help them become a better person. And you believe you are never wrong. Everyone else is. You remember the Fonzie episode, the Happy Days, where he couldn't admit that he was wrong? And the whole time he was like, I was wrong, and couldn't say it. The very end of the show, when I said I was wrong. So that was pride he was struggling with. So, the 80s.
That's right.
And then Laverne and Shirley comes on after that. And then Rose Hawson Prairie and the Daltons. The little days. All right. Number 11, overly obsessed with their physical appearance. Certainly you should take care of yourself and exercise, but when a person is constantly obsessed with how they look, how they flaunt their figure and physique in front of others, with the hopes people will notice and talk at them, this is vanity, which is in a form of pride. So it's interesting, I like to work out. I always say, no one likes a flabby Nelson, especially Nelson. And so I've worked out since I was a kid, really growing up. I played basketball and sports, and then I started working out with weights, and then I got into I started running marathons, and because my mom had passed away, my arm had a heart attack, and so out of fear, I started to run marathons, and then I learned that's nuts. You know, I might as well just work out because I enjoy it or whatever. So when I go out to work out, before they close down all the health gyms, I would go to LA Fitness or I go to Planet Fitness. And I saw it more often in those that went to LA Fitness. But there were oftentimes people, guys, that were like the Hulk, you know, just had like lived their huge muscles on them. And then there were women that I would see. And some of the women, you know, you could tell they were driven by a spirit to work out. You know, some of them were very thin and they were like working out. It was like, it was driving them to that point of an unhealthy relationship. And then there's also those who were strong, muscular-wise, women-wise, and they looked more masculine, more like men than they did women, was not feminine. And I knew that it's the enemy that's speaking to them. You know, they didn't know that, but it's like, it's driving people to do things that are not normal. So when we become obsessed with our physical appearance, we understand that that's demonic. Number 12, unwilling to submit to authority. When a person's unwilling to submit to authority at work, church, home, or any other relationship, it is because deep within the person, they believe they can make better decisions than the person God has placed over them. So they submit outwardly, but inwardly they struggle to accept the subordinate position that they're in. Number 13, ignoring people's attempts to communicate with you. When you consistently blow people off who text or email you, you are essentially minimizing the importance of that person and their communication, and saying to yourself, they're not important enough to invest your precious time into. We all get busy, but acknowledging a person's attempt to connect sends a message and reports to the other person. Now, I will have a caveat with that. If, like, I'll have people who I know their goal is to come against me and waste my time. They do not want to get free yet. And so I have to discern which ones are like that. You know, there's some that oftentimes will help pretty much anybody. But if they continue on, poor, poor, pitiful me, poor, poor me, I'm the victim, over and over and over again. It's like, okay, you don't even want help. All you want is pity. And I'm like, that's not going to get you anywhere. So at some point, you may have to say, okay, I'm not going to invest in this. I'm not going to respond. You know, if you really want help, you know, then you can come see me. But otherwise, until you're ready to do that, then it's just going to be a time waster, unfortunately, on both parties. So, all right. Next, number 14. When we justify our sin instead of admitting it. When someone graciously points out a sin issue in your life and you get defensive and even start to justify it, that is a dangerous place to be, because if you're using scripture to support you, then you're essentially saying that you know better than God. Number 15, name dropping. When you consistently associate yourself with people who are in prominent positions and publicly drop it in conversations in hopes that people will think you are equally as important as the people you associate yourself with, this is a very subtle form of pride. 16, you're on a different timetable than others. So you show up late for a call or a meeting consistently because your time is more valuable than others. 17, pride causes you to get angry easily. If anyone questions your intentions, motives, or statements, you will get angry quickly and go off on them. Number 18, you put around yourself an inner circle of people that will consist of yes men or women who must agree with everything that you say or do. As you get older, the people in your inner circle will then, as they agree with you, will eventually become less and less because people get tired of that over time. Number 19, do you think of yourselves as more spiritual than others in your church? You know, oftentimes people say, well, you know what, I fasted for 55 days last month. Whatever. I think there's only 3 days in a month. Technically, I think you're wrong. You can't do that in 1 month. I'm proud of you for 55 days. But it's like a competition, and they like to drop that. Say, you know what, I prayed in tongues for 60 straight hours. I didn't even take a drink. Oh my gosh, I probably had cotton mouth after 35 minutes of prayer times without drinking. So, but we see a lot of that, and that's religiousness. So, number 20, do you have a touchy, sensitive spirit? You're easily offended. You get your feelings hurt easily. That's pride. 21, do you avoid participating in certain events for fear of being embarrassed or looking foolish because you know that you won't win or look good? 22, you avoid being around certain people because you feel inferior compared to them. You don't feel like you measure up. 23, when is the last time you said these words to a family member, friend, or coworker? I am sorry for what I did to hurt you. I was wrong. Would you please forgive me? That's people that struggle with pride will not say that. And I remember one lady, she was very strongly affected by the enemy, went through some extreme abuse, and she got married and fought and struggled and argued a lot with her husband, and then lied about him to all her friends, and then divorced him, and then got remarried, and then was going to divorce him. In fact, she went, this is like a record, I'm pretty darn sure this is Guinness Book of World Records, living in the same home. Have you guys ever lived in the same home as someone else and then not talk to them? Anyone? Yeah? Not talk to them for maybe an hour, 3 hours, 5 hours? How long? How long was the longest? Yeah? Do you remember how long it was, the longest that you went in the same house without talking to them? A
couple hours.
A day.
A day? Okay. Well, this, what? How long?
Sometimes.
Okay, all right. Well, this woman, true story, I know her personally, her and her husband. She went 18 months in the same home, not talking to her husband.
Oh,
wow. Can you imagine? I'm like, how is that possible? I'm like, my God, that would be possible. She said, look, she'd be walking down the hallway, he'd be walking, and she's like, don't you even look at me? You know, but she wouldn't talk. And I'm like, oh my gosh. So she came to one of these conferences and she got delivered instantly. And she went back and I asked her husband, so how long after she got delivered did you notice something was different about her? He said, it's about 2 or 3 days later. I'm like, what happened? He goes, she apologized. She never did that before. And I'm like, wow. So it's amazing, you know, because pride doesn't want us to ever admit we do anything wrong. It wants us to blame everybody else. And that breaks your relationship. I mean, it's like, who wants to be around that? You know? I'm like, hey, we're all human. We all make mistakes. And we may want to try to do things right. But there's so many people. It's so hard to be around people that have a lot of pride. Because it does. It's like slimes you. You're like, I'm going to get away from that person. Because all they do is bring me down. And they think that they're perfect and everything. So, all right. Next, 24. Do you react to rules? So are there rules that we have to abide by in this world, in church, in business? Yes. So if you have a hard time being told what to do, and you can't listen and obey, then that's going to be a challenge for you. Number 25, do you worry about what others think of you? You're too concerned about your reputation, your family's reputation, to admit the truth. And then I added 26 one just a couple months ago. Pride will cause us to get into financial debt very easily. It will drive us to want to drive like the best car or a bigger house or buy more clothes that we don't need. It's funny because here I am, I'm driving around in my car with my clothes. I got some short sleeves on one side, long sleeves on the other, my suit coats and stuff. And I was gonna put more in there, but I'm like, what the heck, I only got so much room. And so I got like, I don't know, maybe 10 short sleeve shirts and I cycle through them and wear them. People know all my shirts. When I do my Facebook Live, like, oh, there's the purple shirt. Oh, there's the yellow shirt. There's the orange shirt. There's the blue one. It's like, because I'm like, well, if I don't buy new ones, I have to throw the other ones away. I don't want to throw the other ones away. They're good. So, and until they get faded by the sun, because that happens. I got a Phoenix in June when it's 117. And oh my gosh, after a week, it's like all my shirts are the dark and now light in the shoulder area that were closest to the sun. So it's like, oh my gosh, this is horrible. So whenever I do get another shirt, I basically have to throw out an older shirt. So essentially, we need to not have pride in our lives. And it's hard for those of us that have been hurt deeply. That's why it's best to go through having Jesus come to heal our soul wounds. And we're going to do that right now. We're going to go through another session of getting the soul wounds healed because it's so important. It's going to be every session we're going to have here. Because we have been in relationship with people in this world, and it's impossible not to get wounded, not to take an offense, not to be hurt, not to feel rejected, not to feel betrayed, not to all these things that the enemy has. And when we get set free from all of this stuff, we are a different person. We have peace, we get rid of the pride, we have a humility. And it's fun to be around people who are humble, because then it's like, oh, they are like Christ. It's more Christ-like. Those who are prideful and arrogant, it's not fun to around them, especially if they're in ministry, especially if they're in leadership. I had been to some of these larger ministries before I started my own, and I was like shocked at some of the things that these people would say and how they would treat people. They would treat people awfully. Like this one very large, well-known person, he called out some people, was berating them in front of like 3,000 people. And I was like, are you kidding me? I would never do that, ever. You know, and he's supposed to be a man of God, and he is anointed. But there's a lot of people that I have seen who are anointed, who have pride, and it's horrible. I'm like, God, how can you keep, and I don't think gifts are like irrevocable, but the anointing can lift. Yeah. You know, the anointing can be on it. It was gone from Saul. Yes. And Saul was trying to kill David. He was jealous of him. He was prideful. The Lord said, really? I'll take that away from you then. And I will anoint David to do that. Even David got into trouble. You know, and he had a lot of consequences for the sin that he got into. So what I'm going to do is, if Mike can come back and play some soft music again. And so all we basically do is let the Holy Spirit show us some things in the past. And there's a lot of times when we repress things, like we're like, okay, I know something happened, but I thought I dealt with it, and then the Holy Spirit will bring it up and say, oh, this one, oh yeah, I forgot about that, oh yeah, I was kind of hurt by that, oh yeah. And so when we keep getting healed, then the slivers of our soul that were partitioned off, creating an alternate personality within us that will allow us to be triggered when we have something similar that happens to that gets healed. We no longer get triggered anymore. You know, it's amazing when you're around people that get triggered. Like I've been around a few people who have been majorly triggered. And it's like you can be loving them like Christ himself, but yet they can get jealous over something that is shouldn't be. But it's because they got healed, they got an unhealed soul in the past. And when that happens, that is feeling so real to them that they can turn into a different person. And they go off on me for 6 hours and have anger in their hearts, and they're a different person. And they don't know why they're doing it. Well, because they have an unhealed soul. They get that healed, they'll no longer be that way. Like I said for myself, I used to have problems with jealousy. And the Lord took me through deliverance, and it was gone. And no longer did I have that. I'm like, wow, I'm so free. But it feels really bad when you've got that, because you can feel it inside of you. And it drives your mind, and it causes you to say things out of pain. Oftentimes, a rejection in the past, we don't even know that we have. So, what I'm going to do is, again, have everyone close their eyes. I'm going to say, Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit.
And no, you don't say that. I'm going to say, thank you for this prayer. Speak to you about that situation. spirit that attached to that wound, to that trauma, to that pain, to go to the pit now in Jesus' name. Declare it will never affect you again. You will never be tormented. You will never be triggered from that wound in your soul anymore in Jesus' name. That your mind, your will, and your emotions will no longer have the negative effects to any present situations that look like that situation in the past. Thank you, Lord. Okay, I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit again to come and speak to each individual about another trauma that they went through in their life. Give them the vision of it, and that they can feel the toxic emotions that came up within them that hurt them. Jesus, and heal those wounds. Give them words. Right now, take authority in the name of Jesus. I command every demonic spirit that attached to those wounds to go to the pit. Now, in Jesus' name, command every spirit of infirmity that attached to that wound go to the pit now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
spirits telling them what to do instead of hearing the Lord. Unforgiveness and bitterness makes us sick. The enemy's goal is to hurt us as much and as often as possible. And when we get healed from all the pains from the past, then we have the love of Christ within us. We have the fruit of the Spirit that's evident within us. We are healthy and whole, and the sicknesses and diseases cannot attach themselves to us. I've walked in this now since 2009. I've been healed of everything, 11 straight years. No Tylenol, no ibuprofen, no medications, no over-the-counter, and no vitamins. It's God, completely. The Spirit of the Lord lives within me. It's changed my life forever. I have no health insurance, but not had it for a long time. I don't worry about the coronavirus. The only way that the enemy can attach to us is through all the anger, bitterness, hatred, all the things of the flesh, wrath, jealousy, envy, betrayal. Galatians 5:16-26, if we all harbor that within us, so we're not going to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Those of us who have gotten our souls healed and been delivered are going to exhibit the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, faithfulness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Thank you, Father. We praise you, Lord. And I want all of us to stand. I'm going to take authority and kick out Jezebel, Leviathan, Ahab, Legion. Jezebel causes us to control other people, manipulate other people, demand our way, be selfish, have sexual impurities within us. Leviathan causes us to have pride. It attaches to our spines, and it causes us to have back pain, neck pain, insomnia. We can't sleep all night. We don't have good dreams or any dreams. It causes us to fall asleep when we try to read the Bible or Christian books. Ahab tolerates the spirit of Jezebel. It allows things to go on that they shouldn't. It doesn't stand up for purity, righteousness, and godliness. Revival can never happen until we repent. When we repent for our sins, then we become purified by the Lord. And then we have fruit that's evident of the Lord. So we thank you, Father God. We want nothing to do with any demonic spirits in the name of Jesus. So just repeat after me. Say, Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
I choose to forgive
everyone
who has hurt me. I give them to you.
I give them to you.
I pray, Heavenly Father, that you bless their souls to prosper. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus. I ask you, Heavenly Father, to take away all of my pride. I want a humble and contrite spirit. I want nothing to do with the Leviathan spirit. I want nothing to do with the Jezebel spirit.
I
want nothing to do with the Ahab spirit.
Nothing to do with the Ahab.
I want nothing to do with Legion. I want nothing to do with any demonic spirit. Now I'm going to pray. In the name of Jesus, I command right now every demonic spirit to be gone in Jesus' name. I command you to go to the pits in Jesus' name. You'll never come back on them again. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. We just ask you, Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, transform them right now. In the name of Jesus, let them feel the presence so strong, Heavenly Father. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God. Burn out everything that is not of you within us. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father God. We thank you, Father. cleanse our soul wounds. Cleanse us, Lord Jesus, that there's nothing inside that the enemy can attach to anymore in Jesus' name. We break off all witchcraft curses in the name of Jesus. All demonic spirits that were assigned on assignment, I command you now to go to the pit in Jesus' name. We will no longer torment them ever again in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God. Childlike innocence now, we pray, Heavenly Father, to be restored to all of us. Let us have laughter and fun and joy, because there's too much hell that's out there, and we don't want it inside of us anymore. We want to actually have people want what we've got when we leave the church and no longer become like the world and hurt people. We thank you, Father God. We will have a difference within us. We will walk in purity and righteousness and holiness. We will pursue you, Lord Jesus, not out of legality, but because there are so many blessings and favor that you want to put upon us. That there is so much that you want to bless us with, but until we get our soul wounds healed, until we get the demons delivered, you can't trust us, because we will end up hurting ourselves even worse. So we thank you, Father, right now, Lord, cleanse us, purify us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We repent for all that we have done to hurt other people, Lord, in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God. We thank you, Lord, for breaking the chains off. The heavy chains are gone in the name of Jesus.
Praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord.
Well, we go ahead and have a seat for a minute, and I want to just give you a couple of things that are going on. Not the least of which is sewing back into what God's doing here in Nelson's ministry and the Point Church and the Point Live Radio ministry. Some of you know Nelson's going to be on with me tonight on the radio. We reach between 20 and 50,000 people every Saturday night from 8 to 10 Pacific. And so I don't know if you're going to have your live feed on. I'll have mine. I can do it in the studio.
Yeah, probably. Yep.
So what we're going to be on tonight is to be praying for that. But what you give sells back in so we can reach even more people through conferences like this and through the radio ministry. So I'd like to pray. And if you'd like to give by credit card, I have credit card slips here. And I'm going to ask Lolo, if you don't mind, to hand these out in a minute. So you can come up and grab them if you want. And we have a couple pens. But let's pray first, and then we'll take the offering, receive the offering, what God's going to do as far as blessing us. Father, thank you for your hand on Nelson, on Restored to Freedom, on what you're doing in Arlington, Washington, in the Seattle area, through the Point Live Radio, and through Point Church, and just really through us as we submit, as we humble ourselves before you, the Holy God. And so I pray that you continue to fill us up, to strengthen us, to breathe life into us, and allow your living water to refresh each one of us, and we may be refreshing others wherever we go. Use these resources for your glory. And we ask all this in Jesus' name.